sir. From our central communication.
Good afternoon, commissioners.
57.
Just a little. Get my papers here. It's just a little warm in here. This is the 11th budget. I'm 11th time I've been in the budget hot seat.
We won't hurt you though.
All right, thank you. I'm getting my lines together here. What I'm going to do, sir?
Are you nervous?
Just a little bit, sir.
It's the first time.
That's not, it's the 11th. Believe it or not, time flies when you're having fun, right? I'm gonna go over the increases, if that's okay, or not, unless you would prefer that I go through the decreases also.
It doesn't matter. You just take it right down through there the way you want to go.
Okay. Well, I'm gonna go through over the increases and what we're asking for in this budget, and then I'm open to any questions that you may have after that. As we look at our contracted services for Central Communications in this coming fiscal year, as you can see, we're asking for a significant increase. To give you an outline of why we're asking for that increase, go through a list of items for services in the coming year. Our Motorola radios that the county has the maintenance and service agreement on, those costs are going up. And it's not only for the county departments, but we also provide maintenance and service for the radios that are still out there with some of the fire departments. I think it may be one police department that we're still providing the maintenance on. Once the radios are paid off, and I want to make sure that sometime in December, once those radios are paid off, we will, I believe the intent is to give those radios over to them, and from that point forward, they'll be responsible for them, but until that time, we're still responsible for the radios. So that's one of the increases. And also in Crown Castle. Crown Castle is a tower site. That's one of the tower sites. It's located in Mebane. The county has Viper radio equipment co-located on that tower site. And of course, we had to pay rent, and like, you know, they go up every year, a certain percentage, and they're going up again this year, 3%. One thing I want to say about co-locating on the tower sites, as much when it comes to, I don't want to use the word cheaper, but it's less expensive to co-locate with the private sector. Because if we were to go out and try to build our own towers, I mean, we're looking at $1 million, you know, or more in order to do that. So we co-locate and put the equipment on other sites. Compliance Bridge is a records management software that we're asking for our employees. We had asked for Power DMS, and when we looked at the cost and we did a little more shopping around, we seen something that was a little more economical for us. And so that's something new that we're asking for this year. Also, E-Plus. Approximately $25,000 in maintenance for 8 mobile 911 laptops that are used in our backup. Our backup is located over at the fire marshal's office, and we have 4 laptops that are already in place and ready to go just in case we have to leave our main site here in the building. And also we have 4 other laptops that are in briefcases that we can just grab and put on MC1 and keep you know, the services flowing as far as 911 goes. Those are some of the increases in contracted services. And also we're asking for 4 new telecommunicators, one per shift. One thing that we're seeing, that as public safety grow, emergency services grow, the personnel that are out in the field, their units, whether it be fire trucks, police cars, ambulances, or whatever, they're increasing. But downstairs, we're keeping the same number of people in place, and we're expecting them to be able to manage,
you know, situations such as the one we had out here on the interstate where our shift supervisor probably didn't even know what was, everybody was so busy, he couldn't really manage the situation in the room like he would have been if he'd been off the floor to where he can be of assistance to everyone. So we're trying to get it to where our supervisors can truly be supervisors, because currently they're doing the same job as the folks they're supervising. So that's kind of tough to supervise someone and you're sitting there in that room and you're getting hammered along with them. So those are our big increases for this year, and that's why you see overall we're asking for 18.9% increase. But as you look down through some of the line items, we did try to decrease where we could. I know it's not as significant as our increases, but we did look at our current spending and try to decrease where we could.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
On the increases in staff, do you need that increase for each shift, or are there certain shifts that you don't really need if somebody full-time supervising, they can really just work as one of them?
Where we're looking at four new telecommunicators.
Yeah.
And even now, we're trying to, normally we would have seven, sometimes eight telecommunicators in the room working. Even today, we're down to six because, you know, we got people that call, they're sick, and people have to take vacations. I have folks with tons of time on the books. And it's just going to help us to be able to have that supervisor off the floor to where they can really, you know, manage. And maybe at nighttime, maybe we can, you know, scale down a little bit more.
Yeah, that's what I was asking, because I was thinking that not all shifts are equal, and some shifts it's a lot less workload than other shifts, statistically speaking.
There was a time when we could say that.
Yeah.
Now, there have been times where I might call at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and they're just as busy at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning as they are at 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So it just depends. It's like bananas. It comes in bunches, and when it comes, you can't really plan for it. But we're seeing where we could be just as busy in the middle of the night as we are in the middle of the day.
Dexter, what about your number of calls? How have they increased over the last 3 or 4 years?
The number of calls have stayed steady for the most part, but what's happening is now our folks have MCTs out in the field, and so they're entering some calls along with the calls that we're entering. The management part comes in that we still have to look after them even when they're self-initiating calls out in the field. So as far as the calls, what we get over the 911 lines, they're pretty consistent over the last 3 or 4 years, but there has been a little,
And how many is it?
I think it's 109,000 911 calls per year. There is roughly that same amount of administrative calls per year, and we probably have half that amount as far as outbound calls because, you know, well, they're receiving calls, but they're also placing calls. To call for to help, you know, our emergency services.
So you get a call and then you have to call the sheriff or the fire or something like that. Is that what you're talking about?
Well, we get a call and then we dispatch the call. But even before they dispatch, I have emergency medical dispatchers in place that have to process the call. I have emergency fire dispatchers in place that have to process the call. So the call has to go through this what they call the interrogation process, even before we can begin the dispatch. So there's a little more demand and responsibility on us. It's not as, I wish it was, but it's not as easy as just receiving the call and saying, hey, we'll get some out on the way. There's actually a process that can be time consuming.
So your staff is on the phone longer now than they used to be.
Yes, sir. They are on the phone much longer than they used to be.
Yeah.
And you're 911 for the entire county, for each city and
yes, sir.
Central 911.
Yes, sir. Where if you place a 911 call in Alamance County, it will come to us if it's a wireline call, if it's, you know, one that's attached to your house or whatever. But cell calls, when you're on the borders of the county, they could go either way. They can come here or they could go to Orange County. And all the calls for the city of Burlington, we take those calls and transfer them over if it's for fire or police. The medical calls, we also do those.
Well, I know we just approved the tower down around Hallfields, Verizon Tower. Will you have something on that one? It's a new one they're putting in. I know there was, from what they told us, it was a somewhat of a dead area around Hallfields, and
well, we've addressed that area with the Mebane site.
Okay.
And as soon as that site was turned on, I got emails back, and everybody was saying it's great.
Okay.
So
but this is a new one that's going up that we just approved
a couple meetings ago.
That's in between the ones that were there.
It just depends on where the need is. Right. In the future, we may need one. We probably need one further north.
Oh, okay.
Towards the Caswell County line up in that area. But as far as this area here, Mebane, along the Alamance County, Orange County line there, we pretty much got it covered with the Mebane site.
I think Verizon's thought was Hallfields was kind of so much activity going to happen with the new distribution centers there. They wanted to be in place this last tower. So.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Where's that Mebane tower, by the way?
It's on Gibson Road. It's out in the middle of a cow pasture.
I figured it was under a stump as far as my cell phone service is awful.
Maybe the new tower will help you out, right? Dexter, have y'all done any emergency drills? I mean, you know, this time you talk about tornadoes and stuff across the country. And
for us, it's pretty much we get our radios, we get our dispatch protocols, and we go. Now, we have what you call a warm backup over in the fire marshal's office. We go over there once in a while, make sure the equipment's working fine.
That's kind of what I was wondering. I mean, you know, you got laptops and they haven't been upgraded and stuff over time. And
yes, sir.
they wouldn't want to be checking that out during an emergency.
Yes, sir. All that equipment over there is upgraded. When we upgrade downstairs, we upgrade across town at the same time. So it's always on and ready.
How many people do you have under you in that department?
Currently there is, I want to say 29.
So you got 29.
But we have like three vacancies. Okay. So we're probably right at 26 somewhere around.
Fill those with
we're trying.
Push some supervisors in.
One of the other things that we run into is when we hire people, it takes about 6 months just to get them to where we can release them to work on their own. And after that 6 months, you're looking at approximately another year until they really get comfortable in the job. So, and then we're losing folks, especially our younger people. We're losing them. They come in here, and when they leave Alamance County and some of our counties adjacent to us, when they know they've been trained here, they jump on them right away.
Hey, really?
Yes, sir.
Well, do you have a number on that kind of?
The turnover is high. I don't know if I have and Sherry may have that number, but the other thing that we are looking at is a career ladder within his budget that would help with some of the training, some of the additional training for the protocols, the emergency protocols that takes time.
Is there any way we can back charge these counties for being a training facility?
we should. But we realize that you know, especially looking at our emergency services, it is the career ladder and the specialized certifications that are required that really hurts when we do lose people to go to other communities. So we're looking at that, and it's like we mentioned at EMS as well as adding some steps in there. We may not be able to do everything this year, but we're going to, I think, at least start trying.
So the counties around us are doing career ladders, career paths?
Yes, sir.
We're competing against?
Some people just can't take it, isn't that right? I mean, it's too much pressure.
That happens too.
I can imagine that.
And, you know, we need, well, I'm not going to say that, but anyway, that does happen.
Yeah, burnout.
That's a hard job there. That's for
it
sure.
Is very hard. It's very stressful. Yeah. When you're picking up a phone and don't know what's on the other end of that, and all of a sudden you go from 0 to 60, that's very stressful. When you got someone on the other end saying, you know, grandpa's not breathing, They've got, somebody's trying to break into my home, and those folks downstairs, they have to kind of visualize what's going on in that house. And they're putting themselves in that situation with that incident every time, and that does take its toll on you. As a matter of fact, I got one that's, she's one of our star performers, came in and just started hitting home runs, and I'm not gonna say her name right now, but she told me, she said, I think I'm gonna go somewhere else. So I love this place, but the benefits are better elsewhere, and she's leaving for the same pay. And but that's what's happening to us.
Do your people have immunity? I can't remember.
They were working on it, Mrs. Smith, but that's been one of the concerns too, because when you're taking 911 calls, it's nothing to be watching 6 o'clock news, and all of a sudden you hear yourself on the news and everybody's critiquing what you said or did not say. That's stressful. That's very stressful, because we're the one department, we have to bat about 1,000% in order to stay out the news.
That's good, staying off the news. Any more questions?
No, thanks. Good.
Any more to add there, Dexter? Are you good?
No, sir. I think that's it. Thank you, Craig, for
it. Thank you for what y'all did.
Thank you.
That's very important. All right. Next, Mr. Dan Danley with our Burlington Alamance Airport.
Well, thank you. You know, guys, I worked at the fire department before there was a 911. We used to have to take turns sitting at the desk taking those calls. I can't imagine what it's going into now. So those people are in a lot of stress.
They are.
So I think about that. That's amazing. Yeah. Thank you for having us here today. We're looking forward to speaking with you. Our request this year is a repeat of last year's, the same amount of money, and we hope that will work out well. I have a little PowerPoint presentation I'd like to show you, kind of an update on what's going on with the airport and some studies that have been done with results. I have Daniel Finley with me, Dr. Daniel Finley. He's with the Institute of Transportation Research Education. I finally remembered it. It's at NC State University, and NCDOT has been using ITRI for several years now to do studies on investments and return of investments with our government money. So I'd like for Daniel to do a little presentation.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dan.
Commissioners, thanks for the opportunity to present on a couple of studies. Just to let you know, both the studies I'm going to present on, I'm just going to give you the overview of each of those, and they were funded by the NCDOT's Division of Aviation. So both these studies, they paid for us to look at this. So the first thing I'm going to present to you is the same information that's in your brochure. So you've got the brochure there in front of you. And this, what we did is there are 72 publicly owned airports in the state. Your airport here in Burlington Alamance is one of those, and so we look at each of those airports, we look at the community that is around those airports, and to estimate what the economic contribution of that airport to that community are. So statewide, these are large numbers: 123,000 jobs, $32 billion, or over $31 billion in economic output. So this is the business revenue that is supported by airports, $4 billion in income, and almost $1 billion in state and local taxes that are supported by these 72 publicly owned airports across the state. These airports help with local, regional, and the statewide economy. They attract new businesses and create jobs and really link your community to any destination in the world by having that aviation access. Another component of this is the aerospace manufacturing, which is there's a big component of that here in the Triad, and here even more locally in Alamance County. Statewide, those numbers are 42,600 jobs, over $10 billion in output. And when you look at the contribution between the airports and aerospace manufacturing, that's 8.5% of our gross state product, which are supported by those two groups, both the physical infrastructure at the airport supporting businesses and the aerospace manufacturing industry. So a really important part of North Carolina's economy. So that's the big picture statewide. Let's talk more specifically about Burlington Alamance Regional Airport. So I'm going to start with one of the most direct and easiest thing to see if you drive out to the airport, and that's looking at the based aircraft. So you can go out there and you can see Dan's hangars that are full of aircraft, and it's very easy to see those, and then also to track the funds that are coming back to local and county government in terms of the based aircraft taxes that are paid. The tax base on those aircraft is approximately equivalent to 160 homes. And the nice thing about based aircraft is they don't check out library books. They're not calling 911 at 2 in the morning. They're sitting in a hangar. And so you get that tax base without having to provide a lot of services because those are already at the airport. Plus, the other benefit is you actually get those other benefits as well, because somebody who owns an aircraft at your local airport, they also live in your community. So they also have a home and vehicles and other things and support other taxes in the community. If we look at those numbers a little more closely, $124,000 in county taxes annually based on those aircraft that are based at Burlington Alamance Regional Airport. So that's just a small component, one small part of the economic picture. More broadly, we have a one-page summary. This is also summarized in the brochure and in a one-page summary you should have of the airport that just focuses on your local airport. So a few of these numbers here, 76,000 annual aircraft operations. So that's driving that. That's the activity that's going on at the airport. That's people coming in and out, goods coming in and out that are driving this economic contribution study. 122 based aircraft. And when we look at these categories, there's three categories here: direct, indirect, and induced. So when we look at direct jobs, those are jobs that are directly supported by the use of the airport. Indirect jobs are jobs that are supporting the direct jobs. So these are property management companies. These are landscaping that supports the business. This is office supply. So anybody who supports those jobs in the direct category. And then induced is more the payroll impacts. These are people working at direct and indirect jobs. They also live in your community. They shop at your grocery stores. They shop at restaurants. They eat at restaurants. All the money that flows through the economy. So the indirect and induced are thought of as multiplier impacts that are really cycle through the economy based on those direct jobs. So we have the jobs category for each of those three. We also have the payroll income and then the total economic output. So we're looking at over $114 million annually in economic output, 720 jobs, and $32.5 million in payroll income that are supported by your airport. At the bottom of the page, you'll see a list of taxes that are supported by the airport, $1.35 million in business sales tax, almost $1 million in local property tax that are related to the business, so the presence of the business being there generates those property taxes. $660,000 in state corporate and personal tax, and then specifically looking at those based aircraft, $124,000 for Alamance County and $138,000 for the city of Burlington. So that's a summary of Burlington Alamance Regional Airport. I'd be glad to answer any questions about this study, if there are any. Next, I'm going to take it.
I have a question. The city doesn't tax differently than the county does.
Yeah, why is there more? I didn't notice.
Because we're the same. We have the same tax rate. Should be the same, for this right? Past year.
Yeah. So our the base year for our study was 2014-2015, okay, and so yeah, the current year, if you use that same valuation in the current tax rates, they are the same.
So yeah, year back.
Yeah, it's 1 year previous. Okay. Great question. The second study that we had completed for the Division of Aviation, this was of interest at the state level for investments that the state makes into transportation infrastructure, and then what is the payback on that? So this is asking a different question than the study I just presented. This is really a fiscal analysis, so really looking at money the state and local governments invest, and then how much tax revenue they get out of that. And so also the scope is a little bit smaller on this, and so I'll mention that as we go through. And the case study that we looked at locally was Honda Aero. We looked at a 20-year time horizon, and there were infrastructure improvements that local government committed to. So in 07-08, local governments, the airport authority, committed to funds to invest in infrastructure at the airport that was eventually be used by Honda Aero, but they are actually infrastructure improvements there that could be used for others, and some of them were generally applied to the airport. And so that's what we see on the bottom of this graph. These are costs, these are investments, these are also incentives in this case. So these are from the North Carolina Department of Commerce. There's a couple of small grants that Honda Aero qualified for, and in the future years here, looking at from 2012 through 2019, some grants that they qualified for as well. So those are the, on the bottom side of the ledger, those are the costs or incentives or investments that were made. On the top side, we have, in the tan color here, we have state imposed taxes. So these are taxes that are coming back to the state. And then the black here, we have local government tax receipts. And these are only based on really the local property tax that are generated because of those new facilities there. So this is a very conservative estimate. This does not include taxes that are received because of the employees. So there are employees who work there now, who are attracted to the area, who live in homes, who drive vehicles, who shop locally. Those taxes are not included here. This was a very kind of small scope, looking at just the boundary around the airport. And then the black line here shows cumulatively, when you add those investments and then the tax receipts, where do we break even? And that break even point happened in the 2014 time frame. So actually, looking at this point of being revenue positive, of the tax receipts coming in are now exceeding the funds that were used to invest in this property. To give a little more information about that Honda Aero and the background of this study, Honda Aero invested $42 million in the community, 36,000 square foot office space, 58,000 square foot manufacturing plant, and an 8,000 square foot hangar, and they have 72 employees at the time that we completed this study. So looking at how that impact kind of trickled through the economy from a fiscal perspective. So I'd be glad to answer any questions if you have any on this study as
well. So you wouldn't have any of the numbers from the new addition that Honda's doing over there, is that correct?
We'll have any exact numbers on anything other than they're doing a 48,000 square foot facility.
And that was with no incentives, I think. Is that correct?
I'm aware of that.
Yeah.
I have a few photos of just updates what's going around the airport, like seeing if it's all right. Thank you, Daniel. Oh, by the way, Heidi Fisher's with us. Heidi is our executive director's assistant.
Hey, Heidi.
And so, my right and left hand. So these are just snapshots. My cell phone, taking pictures out off on the ramp there out of my office, and day to day, you see what goes on around the airport. Just to let you know how important things happen around the airport. Air Methods provides the maintenance, the helicopters for Duke and Chapel Hill. They provide the pilots the whole nine yards. Their maintenance center is there at Burlington Airport. And there's LabCorp with one of their Pilatuses. And this is a photo of the plane just landed. You see the three vans back up, start loading on the freight. Usually each flight lands, there's three van loads on each one. They do I think they told us 38 operations a day now in a 24-hour period. So amazing what they're doing. Mm. And because they don't have enough aircraft, they contract these guys to provide services to them as they are adding, as LabCorp continues to add airplanes to their fleet as well. Different businesses on the airport. I think right now there are give or take 140 employees for the different businesses on the airport. And you have SkySouth Aviation, that's our main FBO, selling the fuels and the jet fuels and the catering, those type of things, in our little terminal building. But you also have Burlington Aviation, that sells some avgas and has a flight training center. Elon Aviation, so there's Triad Aviation, that does engine work. Bully Aero. Bully is a neat thing to come and see. If you've heard of the Red Bull Racing Team, the Red Bull Racing Plane, Bully builds it in their hangar in Burlington. They just did a race in Austria a few weeks ago. Before that, they were in Abu Dhabi. They go around like a NASCAR circuit, this plane racing circuit. And they're doing it here. They were chosen as the flight crew and the folks to build this plane. And it's amazing what they're doing. They do a lot of air show planes for the air show specialists that are coming in. So they're reaching around the globe. What they're doing is really neat. I'd love for you to come over and see it. Let's see, there's Burlington H&H Propellers. They do the engine and propeller overhauls. And then in the bottom middle picture there is Elon Aviation, new flight school, been there about a year and a half now. And I had to show that because that's my son. He soloed that day, and so I had to, Dad got to brag on his board a little bit.
There you go. But,
so there's a Honda jet. So on this particular day, Honda flew the jet over from Greensboro. The jet in the background flew in from somewhere. They met up, did a test flight, came back in about an hour and bought a Honda jet. So I don't know why they brought it to Burlington to show rather than doing it in Greensboro, but it was just neat seeing it. But as pretty as that airplane is, it needs that engine built in Burlington to make it work. So we're proud of what's going on there, and we just heard about that, what they're doing. There's their building. And this is an overview of, there's the runway end extended, and there's the Honda building. That 48,000 square foot addition is going to happen right there. So, in fact, engineers were on the phone with us this morning doing their FAA paperwork so that they can start this crane work and stuff around the airport. So it's about to happen today now. So we're excited about that. This is just a photo of when the runway extension was completed a couple of years ago. And so we went from 5,000 feet to 6,405 feet. And I like to emphasize five. We ran through something several years ago. We had 5,000 feet. And the FAA sent in new surveys to survey. The runway has some roll in it. So you get a point A and a point B on each end, they shoot satellite survey. It left out that road, straight line. It came out published as 4,999. And we had some smaller jets who had been using this, but no longer were allowed to.
Because of the runway.
And so when we do this next runway extension, I stress to our engineers, any amount of inches you can get beyond the 6,400 in case we ever shrink again. So it's been kind of a joke with us, but I tell people we have 6,405 and we're proud of it.
So what's your maximum size plane that you can land out there?
We can take a lightly loaded 737 now. We can. And this is a Global Express, which looks very much like a 737 if you want to come out there. In fact, it'll be here in the morning, I think. This particular airplane will be. They come in and out very often. This is the type of airplane that the day Walmart came in to meet with Mack Williams and the people and go in and look at the site, this is what they flew. And in fact, the runway opened at noon that day, and they were the first jet to land right afterwards. We had coordinated with their pilots so they could meet with Mack that day with our extension work that had been done. I love to show this. This was in Sunday's paper, but every aircraft you see, except that little silver one, is bringing a student to Elon Moving Day. So, guys, just another idea of your economic impact on our community, what Elon does for our community as well. So it gets exciting what goes on out there. This is a Embraer 145. It's a 50-passenger RJ regional jet, and it's taking the Elon basketball team. That's the thing you're talking about. That's what the team charters to go out of town for their flights for out-of-town ball games. It's amazing. We love it. And I love to show this. This is when LabCorp has their quarterly business meetings there. Our ramp is full. So this is that same ramp from an overhead view. But I just shot that from out my window there, but we're out of space when those things happen. So we are because of that. Oh, Sheets. Now, this is in there not because of the building itself, but Sheets, almost every weekday, at least 3 or 4 weekdays, they're flying in from Altoona, Pennsylvania. They have two King Airs, and they charter two jets, I think's right. Three jets, okay. They're shuffling people from their home office in Pennsylvania to Burlington almost every weekday. Was it one day last week where each plane was making two trips each because they could only put seven people per plane on those little planes? Amazing what Sheets is doing in our community. I just want to make you aware of it. We see it, and it's tremendous in how they're growing. Of course, they're good for us as well. Daniel just showed you the impact in 2016. Go back to 1996. Guys, I was so proud to say we could ship $5 million.
Come in like that, didn't
I? Was. My goodness, how things have grown and changed, and we're just blessed. We've built several hangars in the last few years. This one's about 4 years ago, and this one about a year after. Here we are with 1, 2, 3. This one we just closed out a little over a year ago. We'll probably try to get one up right there before the end of this calendar year. They're all full. Each one of those hold 10 airplanes. You can see that door open. There's 5 doors down each side. They back the airplanes in. And they're individual condos. If you're in your little space, you can't see the guy next to you. But each time we build a set, we get a waiting list of 4 or 5, then build a set for 10. And over a period of months, they're full. So they're all full now. And we've just built a corporate hangar. Let's see. Yeah. I took this course during the winter time, and it's just opened up, but this is across from those. This is a 12,000 square foot hangar. A new King Air 300 is based in there, which is a large corporate aircraft. So, and we're out of hangar space. So you've seen this before, but we are working diligently toward a new air operations center with more space, more room, and able to handle more aircraft and people and car parking. We're very limited with car parking right now. So we're looking forward to being able to do this. This shows you an overview. We're currently in this area. The conceptual drawing is for right there. Grand Oaks Boulevard is there. So the idea is to come straight in from Grand Oaks right into this new center. And something that Mike Williams loves to see, but look at the potential there for some economic development. It's not something we're saying the airport wants or whatever. We're just looking at if we have the hub and center for people to have businesses there, there we are with air transportation next to them. So that, I think that's an exciting potential for the future of
like
our community.
Something like the propeller people, or I mean,
well, it could be an insurance office.
Oh, okay.
It could be anything. The people who use aircraft. Mm-hmm. And to fly to, there we are close by. So we have a business center type thing. Or it could be manufacturing, mm-hmm. like you're saying. But anyway, we've got a lot on the horizon. We're excited. We can't thank you enough for how you support us. There we are. Any questions about anything? Love to have you guys come out and visit with us.
Very good job.
Thank you.
And
yeah, okay.
Well, I was just going to ask specifically what you get from the county. Do you have specific purposes for that?
We do. We don't particularly earmark it, but yes, we have specific purposes for what we get from the county and the city both. For daily operations, we're pretty much self-sufficient, paying the light bill, that type thing. We use your monies. Just about every grant we get is 90% funded from either the feds, FAA, or NCDOT. That 10% funding has to come locally from us, and we count on your monies for that 10% back.
So it's the same for just normal transportation matching requirements?
Yes, it's matching requirements. Mm-hmm. And so we're very fortunate. We get to say yes to a lot of grants because we have matching funds. They're awesome.
So really our money is used to leverage a lot more money.
Your right. money leverages a lot of money.
And I think the state has picked that up some.
They have.
As far as... pushing air.
And then a few years ago, when Honda first came, we were right into this runway extension project, and we had just purchased property where the Honda building is actually built. That property was to get the soils, 1 million yards of soil, to haul over to do the runway extension. And along came Honda, wanted to get into what they were doing, and they wanted to start working 60 days. We were looking at a 2-year project just to get the soils off, so we stopped by the soils. Long story short is the DOT told us, if you can front the monies, then we will reimburse you over the years. And so we went to the banks, had a bank consortium of, I think it was 7 banks that loaned us $11 million. And then the state has been giving us money back each year to pay that, and part of the money you give us helps pay the interest on that note, because we don't get that from them. But again, that was a big leveraging deal because they've taken that concept around other communities. Why can't you do this as well? Mm-hmm. We don't mind reimbursing you if you can front the money.
Right.
So it's been really exciting. Thank you for the way you support us.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
Thank you,
Dan. All right. Lynn, you're next. Family Abuse Services.
Yes, I'm Lynn Russo. I'm the Executive Director of Family Abuse Services. I promise to try to be timely and work it behind schedule. I just want to tell you a little bit about the agency, and then I'm going to talk about what we use your money for. I think everybody has a good grasp that we have an emergency shelter for domestic violence victims. That program everybody is aware of. Unfortunately, we don't have enough beds in that program. Every month, 50 victims call looking for shelter that we don't have space to shelter. So that's something that our agency is looking down the road at, trying to figure out a way to build capacity around the emergency shelter. But the other programs, I don't think people know as much about. The vast majority of our programs are run out of the Family Justice Center. And I'm going to tell you about one particular client because she has used every one of our services. This call came in. We have a new program. It's called the Lethality Assessment Program. And we've piloted with Burlington. We're planning to go throughout the county to all the law enforcement agencies by the end of next year. What it does is anytime there's a domestic violence call, the officer does an 11-question screen with the victim. If that victim scores as high risk for being seriously injured or potentially killed, they call a trained volunteer and have the victim talk to the volunteer. So this case, there was an arrest made. The man had actually tried to cut the woman's throat in front of their four children. So he was in jail. So she could stay home safely that night. But the volunteer encouraged her to come in for the next day to get a protective order and to talk to an advocate. So she came in the next day, and she talked with a crisis advocate. They started the proceedings to get a protective order. She was granted the protective order, and she was assigned a volunteer to go to court with her, because getting a protective order is a two-part process. You go in front of the judge that first day when you're filing, and then you have to go back to court when the other party is there. So we assigned a volunteer. So she had a lap call, which their lethality assessment screen. She received crisis intervention services and was assisted with a protective order, and now she's been assigned a volunteer through our volunteer court navigator program. That program trains volunteers to go with victims, both civil court and the criminal hearings. Going to court is stressful, and when you're going to court to face someone that you're very afraid of, it's even more stressful. So we found that having a volunteer go with them, they're not giving legal advice, they're just kind of guiding them through the process, has been really, really helpful for our clients. So now she's received three services at this point. The protective order was granted by the judge, and as part of that order, the defendant was ordered to supervise visitation, which is also done in our building, but by our agency. So we were able to coordinate, because this family, the level of danger is a lot higher in this case than what we're typically used to. She had a family member where he hired someone to go break into her house and hold her sister at gunpoint and tell her to have the victim drop the charges. And there's also been some threats made about the staff members that have been working with her. So we had to coordinate very carefully with the Sheriff's Department in our building and with Burlington Police Department, because they were the jurisdiction for this case. So we've all been working really hard together. But I'm going to be honest, having him come in to our center for visits kind of felt like having a rabid pit bull come. And I like pit bulls. it was not our typical case. So she's received pretty much every service that we provide in the building. The other thing that's happened in this case has been really, it's hard because this family has been devastated by the violence, but it felt great to watch the community come together to try to protect them. We had a staffing 2 weeks ago now where the Sheriff's Department had four employees there, the Burlington Police Department had two detectives and a supervisor there, probation was there, the district attorney's office participated, the school social worker came, everyone involved in this case came around and tried to figure out how we can best protect this family. The children have been really devastated by everything that's happened. There's four of them. The oldest is about 12 and the youngest is about 5. One of the younger children, they come to support group as well. They come to our support group on a weekly basis. Mom goes to the adults group, kids go to the kids group. And the first time that they came, the little girl looked at one of my staff members and said, "Can I tell you something?" And the staff member said, "Sure." And she said, "My daddy's going to kill my mommy." I mean, these kids, they're in therapy. Mom got them in therapy right away. But the trauma and the devastation that happens in these cases is overwhelming for us. And it's just, can't even imagine what it's like for that person. But to watch the whole community come together and really invest in trying to keep this family safe has been really hope. It gave me a lot of hope. So that's what we do at Family Abuse Services. What we use the county's money for, what we depend on it for, I have grants to pay for the majority of the salaries for the staff members that do this work. But we don't get funding from grants to pay for our operating costs, our utilities, our general liability insurance. There's also those 50 calls a month when it's a really bad call. We have funds to put somebody in a hotel if it's not safe for them to stay home for the night. But those aren't grant funds. Those are just funds that either we fundraise or we get from the local government. And we couldn't do the work that we do and continue to do the good work that we do without your help. Does anybody have any questions? I didn't do a PowerPoint or anything. So.
You did a great job. The advocacy program, I know I've heard in the past a lot of folks that are getting ready to go to court and then they just change their mind because it's, do you find it better with having an advocate to go with them into the courts? And
yes, and we have found there's a reduction in the amount of dismissals when there's a volunteer assigned. The other thing that changed 2 years ago, we started doing the emergency orders electronically. So the victim, where before, they'd come to us, we'd fill out all the paperwork with them, they'd have to drive across town, go to the clerk's office, then drive down to the courthouse, go wave down a bailiff, wait for the judge to take a break, and then hear their case. And then they'd have to go back to the clerk's office and then back to us if they needed additional services. So they're making trips all over the place, which isn't safe, and it was also discouraging. Like, you're taking this huge step, you're trying to get away from the violence, and now you have to jump through five hoops to get this process started.
And I'm sure that the one that's threatening, yeah, they know the whole cycle, mm-hmm, too.
I've actually been with a victim in downtown Graham when the abuser is driving around the traffic circle trying to find her. So luckily we don't have to do that anymore.
That's wonderful having that.
But that program, because they don't no longer have to jump through all those hoops, there's, before we would fill out all the paperwork with a certain number of clients, only 60% of them made it, well 65% made it to the clerk's office, not even to the judge, made it to the clerk's office. Now everybody that wants to file gets to talk to the judge.
That's good.
It's helped a lot.
That's great.
Any questions?
Mm-hmm. I'm good.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, it's my understanding this is a budget hearing. If we want to know what these departments are doing, we should go visit them. I've done it many, many times. I want to know dollars and cents. That's all I'm here for. And this is Friday afternoon, and I've got a lot I can be doing. I don't need to hear what's going on in the county anymore.
Okay, would you like to be excused?
If I want to be excused, I will excuse myself. I don't need you to excuse myself.
No, I'm just asking. I mean...
We'll run the meeting then.
I think it's open discussion for everyone, so...
I think the title is Budget Hearing.
Come on,
budget
Ralph.
Means dollars and cents.
Ralph, for your dollars and cents, sir.
Okay. I appreciate your time here. Don't have a PowerPoint, but we'll get right to the business. Alamance County Transportation, you're aware we run trips for elderly, disabled, and general public with 27 buses that we keep running and provide about 74,000 trips projected this year. When we started 2002, the county commissioners sponsored and got us going. At that time, the support financially was $140,000+, right in that ballpark, and we have continued to receive annually about $140,000 from the commissioners each year. With the exception of this past year, it was $128,000. And basically, we leverage your money to generate about $1.5 million of grants that we use to help pay for the trips in addition to the fares that the individuals pay. We also receive a small amount of money, about $15,000, from the local municipalities. So that is the funding that we receive. We have requested for 2017 $145,000, and I believe in your packages you have the match amounts that we have requested individually. There are match requests for most of the grants that we receive. Rural general public, which we call ROPE, requires a $6,800 match. 5307, which is urban transportation, requires a $12,400 match. Dial-a-ride, which is through the Council of Governments, requires a local match of $12,700. We have elderly and disabled 5310, which is a grant, which is a little over $11,000. This coming year, we'll need a match of $21,000 for capital. Our capital request includes three buses, which we replace once they get 145,000 miles on them, and we have three that will be rolling out this year. In addition, two propane conversion kits. We are in process of moving to propane for all vehicles for savings, and so that would be two of those. And we have administrative match that helps pay our salaries, but the state covers most of that, and that's $39,000. So the total local match that we need is $165,000, of which our request to the county is $145,000, leaving a balance of $20,000 that we hope to get from the cities. And I will mention, just on a side note, there are a lot of people in Alamance County that depend on us for transportation. We take people, we take them to work, we take them to medical appointments, we run a ton of dialysis trips for people that are going to dialysis. We take them to Alamance Community College, and we take them a lot of different places. A lot of people do not have vehicles to get to those places, or they're disabled and cannot drive. And while we do a lot of general public trips for people that are ambulatory, there are a lot of people in wheelchairs and walkers that depend on us. And so I think the service is greatly needed. Any questions?
I don't have any questions. I sit on their board and
right. I think, yeah, when you sit on boards, you do understand what goes on in the county. Very good. Thank you, Ralph.
Okay.
Thank you, Ralph. Good presentation.
Yeah, thank you.
Piedmont Conservation Council, Janet McFall and Rudy Langley. Welcome.
Thank y'all. I'm Rudy Langley. I live here in Alamance County. This is Dr. McFall from Elon. And Piedmont Conservation Council is a resource conservation and development council. It's a group of volunteers. We write grants and fund projects in each of our 10 member counties, from Wake County to Guilford, from Person to Rockingham, Person to Randolph. But what we generally get from Alamance County and from all our counties is a $2,000 dues. And I hope to continue that. We use that $2,000 to pay a part-time project manager and grant writer. And that's the only way we can do that, because most grants disallow administrative costs in the grant. So I hope that we can continue that. Some of the projects that we're working on in Alamance County is things to develop tourism, agritourism especially. Janet's going to mention the local foods thing. We've done past projects like some of the water supply lakes were RC&D projects back in the day. And I hope that we can continue. And Janet wants to say something.
Thank you. I've got to put this down. I'm a little short. Your $2,000 investment has really helped with local food initiatives. We were funded a $25,000 grant from the North Carolina Department of Commerce for a local foods initiative, and that allowed us to do a matchmaking project where we were putting farmers together with institutional buyers. Some of our institutional buyers included Lowe's, Foster Cavaness, Save the Seasons, and what we found is that the institutional buyers are really looking for local farmers that they can't find, and local farmers have product to sell, and they are having trouble connecting with the institutional buyers, and this grant allowed us to put that together. Your $2,000 investment provided me with help to put together the grant proposal to do that. We've also received a continuing gift of software called NetSuite, which is a business management software valued at $45,000 a year, and it's a software program that will allow us to do that matchmaking, to create inventories of farmers and their products and buyers and what they want, and help them connect to foster local food economies. Anyway, so that's sort of what we've done with your $2,000 investment. We thank you, and we hope you continue.
Very good. Any question?
Any questions for me?
All right. Excellent. Moving right along then. Alamance County Dispute Settlement, Jim Barbie.
Thank you very much for giving me a chance to come in and speak with you today. I am representing Alamance Dispute Settlement and Youth Services. As most of you know, that this is a nonprofit agency here that's been serving youth for multiple years. The reason I am here is that the agency is really near and dear to my heart because I helped develop this back in 2003 when I was the Department of Juvenile Justice Consultant for Alamance County. Since then, what has happened is there has been some significant transitions with board resignations, the resignation of the executive director, the resignation of the assistant director. It has really gone through a lot of turmoil, and it's been very heartbreaking for me personally. I work for UNC Chapel Hill's North Carolina Youth Violence Prevention Center. We were asked by the Department of Public Safety to come in and provide technical assistance support and basically help the board get back together and help restructure the agency and moving forward so that we can continue serving the youth of Alamance County. It has been quite an interesting experience, I will say, to get in there, but we are very pleased with the fact that there has been no disruption in services to youth. And with that being said, I believe you have maybe in your packet what we are requesting. It is exactly $30,000, which is of course 50, which is double what we normally get from the county.
Hey,
the reason
two,
we're doing that four. Now I do have something a little easier. Would you like me to hand, may I hand this up? Okay, so this shows you what we are currently receiving and where it's going. I know you guys want to know that. And then I want to show you also.
Yeah, I think we already have that in our book. Thank you, sir.
Mm-hmm. You good, Mr. Smith?
Thank you.
Thank you. And so this year what we are asking for is we are in the process of trying to secure an executive director. I think it's important that we do get someone in here who has the skills to manage a nonprofit, who has the skills to write grants and know how to leverage funding. There's a North Carolina Governor's Crime Commission grant that's going to be coming open in September that we have been asked to apply for. So it's not, I mean, even though it's competitive, we've been asked to apply. So that feels good, but it does require 25% match. It's a $100,000 grant, which means that $25,000 has to be local. Of the $30,000, as you see where it goes, I think most of you know Miss Ella Jing. She pretty much runs the agency, so a third of that's going to go towards her salary. We are trying to make salaries competitive for the executive director. The staff that's currently there, to keep them there, we are wanting to offer some additional benefits. So as you'll see here on the second column, you'll see exactly where we are, what we're asking for per penny. $2,000 is going to go to a bilingual translator because we have seen a significant increase in our Hispanic population of our youth. And we'll also see in line item under professional services and evaluation. I think it's very important for you that you're investing your money, know whether or not your money's working for program and services to youth. So we want to put in an evaluation component, and it's going to cost us a little more than $2,000, but we do at least need that to sort of put that in. We're also training the board of directors. We're doing multiple things to continue to strengthen this organization. I do not think that you would want to see this organization go by the wayside. In the past 3 years, this organization has served 1,872 children in Alamance County. And so our job is to work with them in sustaining it. I do feel like that there are other entities such as City of Burlington, City of Graham. I asked the board of directors, why aren't they asking them for money? They ask you for money. No one could give me an answer. I said, well, you know, let's work on that. Let's get the new executive director in. And so as somebody who's a certified nonprofit manager, and I also am a certified grant writer, I will be producing, I make it my personal mission to work with this agency to continue to sustain it and to grow it so that they do not have to come in and ask any additional money from you or other folks, that we can actually continue services to children. But what's most important to me, especially our Teen Corps program, as you know, North Carolina is the only state left in the entire country that treats 16 and 17 year olds as adults. That means they have a permanent criminal record. Our Teen Corps program, as you know, is a diversion program, which means that those kids don't come in. And what I think is very important, and I think for you also as commissioners, is that what we're trying to do is to create taxpayers and not tax burdens.
So if you didn't exist, what would be the impact on us?
Well, if we didn't exist for the court mediation services that is also through the citizen, there would be no court mediation services. So the personal warrants, where somebody gets mad at somebody and takes a personal warrant, right now they're by law they're required to mediate through us. and it keeps the court costs and services down.
It would increase court costs, would be.
Well, it would increase your population. It would increase more judges' time, more attorney time. So basically, your whole judicial process, I would say probably about 30, we take about 33% of all criminal complaints on the juvenile side and also the adult side that we keep all in-house that doesn't even go into the actual judicial process of the courtroom. The mentoring program is very important. Right now, it takes about $112,000 a year for a youth development center for a kid that's 13 to 15, 16 years of age. We do a lot to try to prevent those kids from going over to youth development centers. Your county detention, you guys have to pay, I think it's 50% of the county detention costs. So we try to keep those kids out of detention as well.
And I think it's also important to mention, we do offer them over at the court services building. They do get free rent.
Yes.
They get free office space. I believe we don't charge utilities.
They do pay utilities.
Oh, they do pay utilities, but they're located right over here
right
at
across the
Court Square, where Veterans Services is.
Yes, and I think that's huge for you guys to provide that. I don't see that. I work in about 18 different counties, and I do not see that other places. So I appreciate you being able to do that for the agency.
Jim, did you say Ella Jean is still working?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
She's a classmate of mine, and she's still working.
She runs the place. We need her. I'm like, how much do I have to pay you to keep you? I mean, we need Ella Jean. I bought her a new office chair. That's the first thing she asked for. She was there, and I went personally and bought her a new office chair.
So are you filling in here?
There's an interim executive director, Bridget Wagner, but she was actually diagnosed with a brain tumor. And so she's having treatment today. That's the only reason she's not here with me right now.
Well, I know y'all do a great job.
But we are in the process of hiring an executive director. We want to bring our financial stuff in-house. It's going to cut the agency expenses for that administration piece of budgeting and finances and payroll. About 50%, we were able to get a payroll company in through a company that we work through, and it has saved $3,700 in payroll. And now the staff over there gets direct deposits, so they're not delayed on having to wait for somebody to sign two separate checks when kind of the way they were doing it. So, you know, but again, the main thing is that the folks over there do a really great job. I was hoping to be out of here in March, but the board has asked us to stay until the next fiscal year starts for July 1. So we are going to work with them in getting a new ED, a new in-house business manager, also a part-time mentoring coordinator. And as you know, I think Dr. Therrell Brown, who was a teen court coordinator, did retire, and Bria Brown's now taking that over. So, but the good news is there's not been any disruption in services since we came
in,
and since all the board resignations and administration. So we feel really good about that. But that additional $15,000, at least for this year, will definitely help us stabilize the organization.
And if you remember, Lisa Dotz was the former interim, or the former director.
They save a lot of money. They really do.
Any other questions I can answer?
Thank you so much.
Thank you,
sir. All right. Our schedule has a short break, so we'll break for about 5 minutes, and we'll be right back. Be caught up. Wendy, would you come up and speak to us quickly?
Good afternoon. I am Wendy Covington, director with Alamance Community Services Agency, and Alamance Community Services, for those of you who may not know, we are one of 37 community action organizations in the state of North Carolina. And community action organizations, our main focus, of course, is to provide services that would have a measurable impact on poverty conditions. We are asking that Board of Commissioners would consider continuing to support our congregate nutrition services. We are requesting $59.5 from the commissioners to support our nutrition program, which we provide services to seniors. Right now we have 303 active seniors who participate in the program, but on an average day we serve anywhere from 140 to 150, maybe upwards 175. We provide a hot lunch daily to our seniors at 5 sites located throughout Alamance County. And last year, you may remember that one of our sites was temporarily closed because of renovations that had taken place there. I'm pleased to announce that the site has reopened. It did reopen last summer, and we have had a significant increase in participation as a result of that. We still continue to have a wait list. We have seniors that are waiting to participate in the program, and we do have a group of folk that reside at Woodridge Apartment Complex that would like to participate in this program as well. One of the benefits in participating in our congregate nutrition program is that it provides or meets the nutritional needs of our seniors. We have seen that there are fewer chronic conditions among our seniors who participate in our program, but the program also provides a recreation benefit to our seniors as well. We noticed that there are fewer hospitalizations, fewer enrollments or admissions to nursing home facilities and so forth. We also see that our seniors, many of them tell us that without this program, they would not have any other means of getting a meal. And some of them only have this one meal per day. We also have a partnership with the Elon University, their campus meal program. And two of our meal sites, those participants receive an extra meal once a week on Wednesdays, and they take that meal home with them. Again, many of them are grateful that they can receive that extra meal as well. The funding that we are asking you all for will help us to continue to meet the needs, the nutritional needs of our participants in the program, but also we have some equipment that we do need to purchase. Our site managers who actually manage the sites at the different locations, some of them are seniors themselves, and so we see that they have a need for some assistance, and we're asking that the funds be used to so that we can purchase a hydraulic lift at two of those sites. We also need additional warmers at two sites as well. The meals actually are provided by GC Partners, and they are in Greensboro. And by the time they arrive, which usually is around 10 o'clock, we don't serve until around 11:30. So a lot of times we do have to make sure that the food remains warm. So a couple of our sites, they're using the oven that is existing at that facility, which of course doesn't really, we feel like we don't have the ability to keep it as warm as we possibly could if we had actual warmers there. So we do need to purchase two warmers at those sites there. And also we do need some other equipment, such as two of our sites do not have a telephone. We have to use the phones that exist at those facility. So we would like to purchase phones for our site managers to use. And also, we ask our seniors to contribute a nominal amount every day, and they actually choose the amount that they want to contribute. So those contributions are collected at all of the sites, so we need cash boxes as well so that we can collect those contributions. The annual amount that we collect from those contributions is around $21,000 to $23,000 a year. So this actually helps us to be able to expand services to others, seniors as well. We hope that we will be able to move some people off the wait list as well. I would love for us to be able to serve everybody that's on the wait list. We currently have about 31 that's on the wait list, but unfortunately we can't serve everyone. We do want to serve those who have the greatest needs. So our goal this year is to try to move as many as we possibly can from the wait list so that we can serve more seniors and meet their needs and help them to remain independent in their late years. I do want to say that the average age of our seniors is 83. That's the average age of our participant. And also, we also work with ACTA, who provides transportation to two of the sites, Graham and the John Robert Knodel site. ACTA provides transportation for our seniors who have no other way of getting to the sites. Any questions?
So your request,
59,500.
That covers the warmers and helping with
that's
the cost
for the
meals and
upgrading and
yes.
the lifts stuff. And everything.
Yes.
So you mentioned Graham and John Robert Colonel.
Mm-hmm.
What were the other three sites?
The other sites is Burlington Homes and the Willows. Burlington Homes is located on Everett Street, which is near downtown, and the Willows is on Tarpley Street.
Tarpley, right. And that's four.
Yes, four sites. We have four sites.
Oh, I thought you said you had five.
No, we have.
You would like
have
to
four.
Have five.
We would love to
I
have five.
Say.
We have a group of seniors at the Woodridge Complex who want a site located there. We're encouraging them to participate in one of the existing sites for right now, and we have a couple of them who do attend there. But at this time, we're just encouraging them to participate in our existing site.
So the folks like at Burlington Homes, say they just are there.
Right. Those who participate at Burlington Homes and at the Willows apartment complexes mainly are those who reside there.
Okay.
There are people who live in the neighborhood who can attend if they choose to do so, but the participants, the majority of those participants actually live in the complex. And at Burlington Homes, some of those participants are 55 and up, because that's the age eligibility to reside there in that complex.
And what's the requirement to qualify to participate in this?
To participate, you have to be an Alamance County resident, age 60 or older, or reside in a housing community for seniors, and or you could be the spouse of someone who is age eligible, or a child, a handicapped child that lives in the home with a senior as well.
The sites that I've visited in the past, they're generally pretty frail, older people.
Yes, that's what I was saying. The average age is 83. You know, we are working on to attract those younger seniors who are turning of age, and we do have a few, but most of the people who participate, as Bob is saying, they're frail, they're older group, and of course, many of them have some chronic conditions as well.
Thank you, Wendy.
Thank you.
Appreciate
Thank
it.
You. We do appreciate your continued support.
And next, we will have Deborah Welch with Cardinal Innovations.
This is the first time that I have done this. Everybody just have to be patient with me. Cardinal Innovations Healthcare Solutions is your mental health, intellectually disabled, substance abuse, LME, serving, managing the funds as a managed care organization. We have been granted through the years $1.2 million for the care, and the majority of that, $1 million of it goes to the crisis center that is manned by the provider RHA. That's over on Ann Elizabeth Drive. That's a diversion from the ED so that folks, if they're in need or decompensating, they have a place that they can go to where they can get assessed and have a prescriber, and then if they need to be taken on over to the ED, they can be. and they work with Burlington Police Department to be able to have transportation. The remaining funds are used, Alamance Regional Medical Center receives a portion for two nurses that will go to the emergency room and do assessments for behavioral health patients that present in the emergency room. Alamance Regional Medical Center has done a lot to work with us to make sure that the folks with these type of issues are not in there with the folks that are having other difficulties. They actually have a hall now where they can be and have a little different care, and we really appreciate that a lot. There's also funding that goes for transportation for Ralph Scott Life Services, RTS. Those are for folks that need to get to the detox center that may not have another way of transporting. Ralph Scott Life Services, that's for the folks that go to the day programs. We also have funds that come from, there are two CCCs in Alamance County, and those are comprehensive clinical.
Community clinics.
These are comprehensive community clinics. They are actually given additional funding through Cardinal so that they will do at what we call an open access. So you have two places that providers where people can go and get mental health services through the network of the psychiatrist, psychologist, and licensed clinical social workers. And a portion of what we use from Alamance, when you see it on our dashboard report, you're going to see that it says Yanceyville. The reason for that is when the state gives the money to the MCO, it comes as Alamance Caswell money. Caswell's portion is $125,000. All of Caswell's money comes to Alamance County because we're the only ones that have a hospital or a crisis center. So in the last couple of years, what we've been able to do to divert people from having to come from Caswell to go to the Alamance Regional Medical Center, we've been able to house in a federally qualified health center, which is Caswell Family Practice. And 5 days a week, there's a clinician there that can do assessments on the spot, and then they have a prescriber in the building if they need to do that. This diverts folks from being brought down and having to use the ED at ARMC or even the crisis unit at Ann Elizabeth. And we appreciate very much all the money that we're given. I don't think it's changed in all the years I've been doing it, but we're making it work, and we've got some of the greatest providers of services in the state, and I hear lots of really, really awesome things about Alamance County no matter where I go. Your folks are being taken care of. We make sure and monitor that they are being well cared for, that the facilities that they are in are up to contract, and that the money is being used in a mindful way. Do you have any questions?
So your budget for this year is the same as last year, 1.179556.
Yes, it varies a little bit. The county money is where we were able to do last year. We've been trying to train in mental health first aid training, which is just CPR for the mentally ill. It's an awesome training, really helps folks everywhere would benefit from it. So we took a portion of the county dollars and bought the materials so that the social workers and the school system, the teachers, anybody in the school system that wanted to be trained in mental health first aid, we paid for the, the books and the what they need for their training. That was a really great thing. So it's a little bit more flexible with that.
Okay. Any questions? Comments?
Well, I'll just say that when I sat down with Deborah and somebody from Cardinal on a regional basis, the amount of money that the county supports Cardinal is really the amount that we used to support in the old system, the old LME system and the mental health authority system. And we have some latitude, as it was explained, on how we want our money to be utilized.
Absolutely.
And I'd suggest we leave it like it is for now, but as we continue to go down this path of addressing the level of mental illness in our county jail, and maybe some of those monies can be redirected or expanded upon
And that would be something in this fund that we could possibly.
Well, that's correct. And I mean, a lot of this is crisis intervention anyways.
It is.
And that's probably one of the biggest diversionary strategies in the.
We would also really, and may be able to work with, we'd really like to help Ms. Osborne with DSS with the difficult placements with comorbidity children that are mentally ill and have IDD. There's a lot of times where they are betwixt and between, and the money needs to be, and so she has to draw county money. This money here, if we had a little more flexibility, and we do, and you do, and I would let you know that, but we would really like to be able to partner with her and help her with, it just seems like her numbers keep growing too, so.
Well, I think as we all get more engaged in the ongoing operations of Cardinal and how the money's being spent, our providers will probably see some changes. We'll be coming back recommending some changes.
Thank you, Deborah.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, next we have Amanda of Meals on Wheels.
Good afternoon. I'm Amanda Bartolomeo, and I'm the Executive Director for Alamance County Meals on Wheels. Currently, we are receiving approximately $58,000. This year, we were increasing requesting a 5% increase, which would be approximately $61,800. We heavily depend upon these funds, which are to provide home-delivered meals to the elderly, homebound seniors in our county. This is a very conservative amount that we are requesting because we know there are a lot of other resourceful programs in our county that need the funds as well. So I'll start by giving you just a little background on our program. I'm sure most people are familiar with Meals on Wheels, but we do provide one hot lunch every day, Monday through Friday, weekdays, to the homebound seniors in our community. And we have 24 routes. We have 19 hot routes, and they receive their meals every day. And then we have 4 frozen routes, and they receive 5 meals one day a week. And those are for the clients that live in the far reaches of the county, so the meal wouldn't be hot by the time that they received it. So to tell you about the need for the program, studies have shown that the Meals on Wheels recipients that receive our meals really show improvements in their overall health and quality of a life. This includes mental health, reducing falls, and improved feelings of isolation and loneliness. So even that one-time visit each day, some of our clients, that's the only person that they see each day. And whenever the volunteers come by to visit them, they're standing there waiting at the door and very excited to have someone asking about their day and just how they're doing and that sort of thing. And it really just helps boost their mood throughout the day. It also helps them to have decreased worry about being able to live alone and being able to stay in their homes. A little bit about the demand for the program. So we receive referrals every day, multiple referrals on a daily basis. We're the only agency in our county that provides home-delivered meals to the seniors in our county. And currently, our waiting list is over 100 clients. We're currently serving approximately 306 clients. We wish that we could serve all of our clients, but at this time, we do have to carry over a waiting list. We are very strict on our requirements, eligibility requirements. It's not based on income, but it's more of physical ability. So the person has to be over 60, they have to live alone, unable to prepare meals for themselves, and have less than 20 hours of in-home aid. So we really have to keep to those requirements just to keep the people on that are really in desire need for the program. And we do go out and interview our clients before we put them on the program. We have a social worker that goes out and conducts an initial interview, as well as goes out every 6 months. So some people's situation changes every 6 months. So if it's changed and we find out maybe they have a son or daughter living with them, then we would take them off the program and put on someone that really doesn't have any help. Let's see. So the impact of our program. Our program serves approximately 100,000 meals each year. And again, this has helped to show improvements in their health and overall social well-being as well. Let's see. Benefits to the community. It helps to decrease costs to the community, and this is by reducing the hospital visits and admissions. So nutrition really plays an important part in everyone's life, but especially older adults, especially things such as dehydration could send someone to the hospital, and just one-time meal could really change that for that person. So studies have shown that this has really helped to decrease the cost of having these seniors admitted into the hospitals, and even long-term facility cost. Another benefit to the individuals and families, besides receiving this nutritious meal each day, is that we're checking on the clients. And this is a very important part of their life, especially at their age and whenever they have multiple health problems. But if someone doesn't answer the door that day, the volunteer calls our office and lets us know, and then we call their family to check on them. So each day we are having contact with that client. They're not allowed to leave it on the porch or anything like that, but we have to see the person face to face. So family has found that very important, especially if they're out of state or working full time, but it's a nice little safety check that they know that someone came by in the middle of the day and laid eyes on their loved one. Another benefit is, as we said, the social visit and the safety check each day. As far as funding, we encourage our clients to pay as they are able, but we don't want them to feel like this is a burden and that they have to pay for the program. We do have about 15 to 16 clients that pay for the full amount each year, and then other people just pay as they're able. So some people aren't able to give anything, some people give a couple of dollars, and then some pay for the full amount. So that is, and that does contribute to a small portion of our funds, as well as we have several fundraisers throughout the year, and then we apply for grants on a regular basis as well. We really depend on the community for support for our program. And our clients really appreciate the support that you give them. And I think that's about all I have. Do you have any questions?
What would be the cost for a year?
It's about $1,400, $1,400 to $1,500 per client. So whenever we put on a client, we have to think about how long they're going to need it. So some people only need it for a couple of weeks, and that's usually people that have waited too long to turn in a referral. Sometimes family thinks about it at the last minute. And then we have other people that may be on for 10 years or so that their health just kind of remains consistent.
My mother used to deliver these meals.
Oh, that's great.
Well, I went out for the first time.
She's deceased.
Oh.
I went out on a rock. What do you call the day?
Community Champions Day. I was going to mention that. We were very fortunate.
Invited to make go out with somebody on a route. Yeah. And I just saw a lot of poverty and a lot of severe medical issues.
You never believe people would live.
Right. And I think Bob had a really good example of a client story on his route where a client was talking about where he was going into diabetic shock. Wasn't that your route?
Oh, yeah.
Where and he was saying he felt so bad he couldn't say anything, but he wrote a note to the volunteer that he needed help. So we called EMS, they called the family, and then the physician said that if he arrived at the hospital a couple minutes later, he wouldn't be with us any longer. So he was just telling his story and how thankful that he was for the program.
Very good. Anybody else? All right.
Thank you
very much. Thanks for what you do.
Great, sir.
Okay, next we have the Division of Forestry. I saw Keith come in, but we got John Howard down. So.
Yeah, John... he got sent to California. He's teaching one of our advanced fire training courses out there. And Susan has got the handout I brought. She can give it to you after I get finished. This year we did go up a little bit. We're asking for $199,194 this year. I think it was up last year was $168,000. We added a truck in the budget this year. The truck we're replacing is a 2008. It has almost 100,000 miles on it, and with this as a first line initial attack vehicle, we try to keep them in a number one shape and replace them about every 5 years or 100,000 miles. Our equipment operator, which Alamance County pays half of the funds for his salary, he quit last week, so we probably won't use a good portion of that for his salary, because it's going to take probably 6 months before we get him replaced. So this is a little bit off. North Carolina Forest Service is a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week, 365-day job. There's somebody on call to cover Alamance County all year round. Since we are on call and respond to wildfires, we have investigative and law enforcement responsibilities along with the suppression actions. I just got back from the 15,000 acre wildfire in Dare County. Sam, he just got back from the mountains. He was on two fires up there, the State Line Fire and Silver Mine Fire that was on the news. Whenever anybody in North Carolina needs help on wildfire suppression, they usually call people that's out of the impacted area. Same thing with a disaster. If the local folks are impacted, we draw from counties that are not impacted with that disaster to provide help. We have some accomplishments for last year and this year. We wrote 20 management plans and assist last year, which is down from the previous years because we have started charging for management plans now. We did come up a little bit this year, up to 53 already, but most of those were assist instead of a full-blown management plan because we're charging. We had 27 tracts harvested with 527 acres and 800 acres planted last year, with almost a 500,000 trees planted in Alamance County. So far this year, we've had 35 tracts harvested for 987 acres, and we have not completed our tree planting acres, so I'm not exactly sure how many we got planted this year. School programs, we did the state Envirothon, which has around 800 high school, middle school kids plus volunteers, so you're looking at probably 1,200 people. Comes to Cedar Rock Park every year, and we're usually the lead on the forestry station for that. We also have central office people that come and help with the oral presentations when it relates to forestry. We've done the couple of rural town meetings this year, 8 or 10 high school and middle school career days, logging inspections. We did 74 inspections with 32 of them for active inspections while they were still logging, trying to fix the problems that we see before they move off and have to come back. We have about 1,271 acres that was logged. That was last year. This year we've already inspected 59 logging jobs with 21 of them being active for 1,096 acres.
Questions? Is that 60%, 40% division between state and county, is that consistent with all counties, or is it vary from county to county?
Used to, there was some negotiation and variation, but I think all 100 counties now are a 60-40 split.
So in doing this, you're asking for 13,000 more from us, and I guess the state will contribute
right
their percentage more also.
Right.
One little question. You said y'all had to go out on a call in other parts of the state. Mm-hmm. When you go, what equipment do you take with you? Are y'all just...
It depends on the job they're sending us for. Most of the time, we're going to drive our pickup truck or our engine.
Their equipment on site.
Right. Usually, I'm with the management team now, so I'm going to be sitting in a room somewhere on a telephone or a radio, but I'll either drive that or pick up an empty pickup truck if I need to haul equipment when I get down there that we have a reserve at our district office.
So this new piece of equipment may
not ever... It's replacing my truck.
Okay, that's your initial attack vehicle.
Yes, and it's a... Don't look like it, it's not red, but it is a fire truck.
Okay. Any other questions?
I would like to say, Commissioner Russell, that they sent us a reimbursement request. So if they do not spend the funds that they are asking for, we're not funding that.
Okay.
So it's only 40% of the actual expenditures.
Right. We don't receive these funds until we spend it, mm-hmm. and then we bill the county.
I got you.
When you're out of town like that, are you on some sort of per diem from that county? Or?
It depends on who we're working for. If I go in-state, usually once we get on-site, we have what we call a buying team now, that any expenses incurred, they're paying for it. We usually set up either a caterer or restaurants that we go to that work with us, and we have a sign out sheet. All the firefighters put down their position, their name and everything, sign the ticket, and then the buying team comes by the next day and pays the bill. When we're in travel status going back and forth, we are on per diem. If we're working for the feds have a buying team that does the same thing, but when we're in travel status, we're on fed per diem.
All right. Thank you very much, Keith.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate it. And with that, we'll conclude and have a meeting Monday night and Tuesday morning.